Morning, I am Damiano Taurino from Italy, and I'm very happy to be with you today at this conference. First of all, please let me thank the organizers of both the conference, the HIPIC conference, and of the Drone SC workshop for this very interesting opportunity they gave me to present a keynote today. So we can start with my presentation today that is called Harmonizing the Drone Standards to Support the Ongoing EU Regulatory Framework. So please first of all, leave me a couple of minutes to present, to introduce myself. I'm a PhD and I'm a computer scientist with a past background in security and computer vision. I joined Deep Blue, and so I joined the drone sector in 2009. I work for a company that is that works in R&D for aviation and other safety critical domains. And we have a drone department, and I'm leading this drone department in the company. Okay, I talk about drone, you know that several names have been given to these kind of platforms, like UAV in the past, UAS, FPAS. Luckily, the European Commission told us that we can call them drones, so it is easier for us to call like this. For the rest of my presentation, I will talk about drones. I'm the coordinator of several European national projects on drones and automation. And I'm currently the coordinator of the AW Drones project. That is one of the main topics of today's presentation. I'm a trainer at Eurocontrol Training Center. In particular, I work there for in my courses about the RPS regulation and the course about liability and traffic management. Both of these courses are held in their premises in Luxembourg, where is the main premise of the Eurocontrol Training Center. I'm a certified theory course trainer for FPS pilots, and I love playing tennis, even if I'm not that good at this, still an amateur in the sector. Okay. So what we'll talk about today, we'll talk about three main topics. One is the importance of a coherent and comprehensive regulatory and standardization framework for drones, both at European and global level. How the AW Drones project addresses this challenge. And I will show you and introduce you a web tool for the whole drone community. It's called the Drone Standards Information Portal. So let's start with the regulatory framework with particular reference to Europe. So the European Europe has led and is leading the rulemaking process for drones at a global level. Since 2004, where they started the first approach, the first effort with Eurocontrol and the Commission, EU is trying to put together a fully integrated and harmonized regulatory framework for the Union, for the EU. Big processes has been done since 2004, and now we have this comprehensive and fully implemented regulatory framework for drones. In particular, in 2018, we finally had the extension of the mandate of EASA to drones of whatever mass. Before 2018, EASA was supposed to rule only drones below 2,050 kilos of mass, while the other categories were demanded to the national aviation authorities. Now, since 2018, EASA is able to rule them all. In 2019, two big cornerstones of the European regulation have been issued. They are the regulation 945 and 947. And this both set the framework for safe operation of drones in the European skies. So in the EU and all the member states of EASA, that also include Switzerland, Norway, Iceland, Liechtenstein and other countries that are not part of the EU, but they decide to share the same rules for the civil aviation. Last year, in 2020, also EASA published some guidance material and adequate means of compliance for the regulation. We'll see later on during the presentation what does it mean. And the EASA is also working now on the regulation of use space. So that specific platform that will regulate the traffic at very low level, including drones. This regulation is still under development. During the last year, an opinion by EASA has been published, and also public consultation have been concluded last year. And so we expect for this year to have a first version of the EU space regulation in Europe. Okay. What is one of the main regulatory achievements? So one of the main objectives that have been met by the EU with the regulation, in my opinion, this is the definition of a clear operation-centric and risk-based regulatory approach, regulatory framework. Operation-centric means that all the regulatory framework is based with an approach on the operations rather than only based on the airworthiness of the platform. So everything is built with an eye to the operation and the safety of the operation. So the rules have been built to be proportional to the risk that is posed by the operation. And it has been achieved through the definition of three categories. What does it mean proportional here? It means that we have very different types of operations that can be performed with a drone. And we have also very different categories and sizes of drones. So the rationale behind the categorization and the proportional rule for drones is that it is not the case that the very large drones flying, for example, internationally or bringing on passengers and so on, and the very small drones flying very low level, far from people, it is not the case that they need to share the same rules. So there are different rules with different levels of robustness, different levels of compliance that are requested for the drones flown at different categories. In particular, we have three categories in the EU regulation, in the EASA regulation. We have the open category that represent all the operations that are flown in visual line of sight, so always directly under the visual control of the pilot, not overgathering of people, and with drones with a mass of less than 25 kilos. And so basically the operations that are inherently safe, not so risky for the public. Then we have the specific category that are in the middle, are those operations for which they do not fall under the very simple open category, but they are not yet as complicated as manned aviation. And so they fall in this intermediate category. And then we have the certified category. Here, the level of risk associated with the public, with third parties, is very high, a safety risk. So the rules and compliance needed to these rules is very high and is similar to the manned aviation, to the rules that are already in place for manned aviation. Here, I want to show you a funny video that has been produced by EASA to show you the rules to be followed under the open category and why we call it buy and fly.
Hey, so you're my new pilot.
Wow, unbelievable.
Before we can hit the skies, you've got some stuff to do. You need to register online, complete the training, and pass the test. Wow, that was easy. you're not just a pretty face. Good that you check beforehand where we can and cannot fly.
Oh, sorry.
Even a smart guy like you knows better. Read the manual. Oh. You want to fly me or not? Ouch, Paul! Are you serious? Keep me in sight, always. You don't want to lose me. Are you nuts? Don't fly me higher than 120 meters. And not too close to other objects, to airports, or over groups of people.
Okay, I understand. Oh, cool, a pool party.
Ouch, that's not funny, Paul. We can't take photos or videos of people without their permission. Flying a drone is really fun and not so complicated if you follow some rules. Register yourself, check where you can fly, keep the drone in sight, and do not fly above 120 meters or close to obstacles and airports. And do not invade privacy. Then, you're a really good pilot.
Okay, as you saw in the video, the open category includes some very simple rules that have to be followed in order to perform such kind of operations. So, a full authorization by the authority is not needed. It is sufficient that the rules explained in the video are followed by the pilot, by the operator. Within the open category, we have three different subcategories. And related to these categories, you can see here A1, A2, A3, based on how close you fly to other people not involved in the operation. Associated to these subcategories, you can see here in the drone class column that there are some associated classes of drones. Here, C0, C1, and so on makes reference to the fact that these drones are marked with a C stamp, so following the product regulation for products imported or produced in the EU that are sold in the EU. And these CE marks are categorized from C0 to C4. So you buy them at the shop, and they already come with a CE mark, so you can use it, provided that you follow the rule of the open category. On the other hand, we have the certified category. Here, the risk associated to the operation is close to the one posed by normal manned aviation operations. Which kind of operation could fall under the certified category? For example, the drone taxis that will be deployed in the future in our cities, or cargo drones flying over urban areas, for example, a drone dropping Amazon packages in a city, or even in the future, large jet-engined drones. For example, we can have a very large international, a very large airplane like Airbus or Boeing 1 flying internationally from Paris to New York, bringing on passengers or even freights. So if they are cargo flights. The regulatory approach here, since we have a risk-based approach, is for sure very similar to the one used for manned aviation, because in the case of accidents or incidents within this category, the risk posed to third party is comparable with the one for manned aviation. It means that in this category, you need to have a pilot license, a full pilot license. You need to have a certificate for the operator, so the organization of the operator is certified, and you also need a certificate of airworthiness for the aircraft. This category have not yet been fully ruled by EASA. And the first proposal for the regulation will be published later on this year. In the middle, between the open and the certified category, we have the specific category. In other words, the operation not covered under the open category, but not risky enough for the certified one, fall in the specific category. In the specific category, there is also another classification. You can fall under, your operation can fall under the so-called standard scenarios. The standard scenarios are some specific concept of operations that are defined by EASA and or the National Civil Aviation Authorities. In the case in which these simple standard scenarios are respected by your operation, you do not need to have an authorization from the authority. You simply state to the authority that you are flying within their standard scenarios. For example, if the Civil Aviation Authority of Italy or EASA itself publishes a standard scenario for inspection of critical infrastructures far from urban areas, and you are able to demonstrate that you follow under that scenario with your operation, you do not need to ask for a full authorization. Otherwise, if you don't fall, if your operation doesn't fall in the standard scenario, you need for an authorization by the competent authority. And you have three options here. Maybe that your operation is something that the Civil Aviation Authority has already seen in the past, and they already defined some predefined risk assessment. So the kind of operation is well known, and the authority already knows the level of risk that is associated with that specific operation. In the case of which your operation doesn't fall within the predefined risk assessments published by the authorities, you must perform yourself the risk assessment. The regulation by EASA also proposes a methodology to perform this safety risk assessment. This is called SORA, Specific Operations Risk Assessment. This is a process, something like an algorithm, that includes a lot of requirements, some mitigation factors, and so on, that are needed to define the level of risk that is associated with your operation. If the level of risk is deemed acceptable by the authority, you will get the authorization. A third way is to get a light UAS operator certificate. In this case, the operator is asking for a certificate for its organization and its procedures. So you fall here in a procedure that is quite similar to the one for the certified category for the UAS operator certification. In the case you get a look, you do not need to ask for authorization every time you perform, you carry out operations. You have your look and you can perform you can carry out the operations that are already included in your manual of operation. That is, that has been acknowledged by the authority. Okay, we have talked about the regulatory framework, but what's the relationship with between the rules, so the regulatory framework, and the industry standards, the technical and operational standards? EASA and also FAA in the States often refer in the regulation to voluntary industry standards. Okay, you can see them in the European Technical Standard Orders or in the FAA Technical Standard Orders, and they are disseminated here and there in the regulation. What does it mean? That the standards are not considered binding by the regulation, but if you use them, this can be assumed as an acceptable means of complying with the rule. What does it mean? You are not forced by the law to use those standards. They are not the only way to reach compliance to the rule, but you know that if you use those standards within your processes, within your manufacturing and so on, at the end of the process, your product or your operation will be compliant with the law. Okay, will be compliant with the rules. And here we come back to the previous slides when we talked about publication of acceptable means of compliance by EASA. It means that EASA published some ways to be compliant with the law. And it may include the adherence to these voluntary standards. There are several organizations around the world publishing standards for whatever domain, not only in aviation. In the aviation world, the most important, or the ones that are worth to be mentioned here, are ASTM or RTCA from the States. Then there is EuroCAE here in Europe. We have ISO with a global scope. We have also SAE in Europe and so on. So there are several standard development organizations publishing standards for aviation, and in particular, in our case, for drones. So, what is the problem now coming back to the drone? Coming back to the drone case. What is the problem with this relationship between rules and standards? So, even if you have a fully deployed or in deployment regulatory framework, if you have lack of an harmonized standard framework that is matching the regulatory framework, it can hold back the development of drone-related business. And several studies commissioned by the EU, but also by other states, somehow alerted then at the moment there is this sort of misalignment because we do not have yet reached the point where the reliable regulatory framework is fully aligned with the standard, with the standards and a full development of standards for that specific framework. And when we'll reach that point, this will be one of the main potential boosters for the drone business, for the business. Okay, it is not fault of anyone because, okay, the regulation is still evolving and ongoing. On the other side, we have standard making bodies that are working a lot, but they are producing a big number of standards and maybe they have not yet fully covered some of the topics and so on. But this is a fact that the rulemaking process and the standard making process are not fully aligned. In order to foster the growth of and the safe usage of drones, there's still a need to implement a coherent and also interoperable global standard framework for drones. It is in the interest of the EU, but also in the interest of other states around the world. The problem can be also seen from the side of the manufacturer or the operator. How can I find my standard in the jungle? In fact, you saw that there are a lot of STOs, standard making bodies, working on development of standards for drones. And they range from electronic to software to airworthiness to specification of a spectrum transmission and so on. It is not immediate and easy to understand for a potential manufacturer or operator of drones, what is the relationship between the standards and the applicable rules, for example, the EASA rules, or even the relationship between the standards and the categories of operations for which those standards can be used. And inside the specific category, for example, the specific category, you don't know whether a specific standard is associated to a certain level of robustness or integrity. Those concepts are taken from Zora. So in practice, the information is difficult to trace, to digest, and to consult. And it's difficult to understand whether a specific standard is applicable to a specific case for an operator or manufacturer. A possible potential answer to this challenge is brought by the AWTrans project. It is an European project that has been funded by the Commission 3 years ago, and it is led, coordinated by the EBLU, but includes in its consortium a lot of different stakeholders coming from the whole domain of drones. So we have, for example, research centers like DLR and NLR from Germany and Netherlands. We have a university, the TU Delft. We have DJI. We have, that is a big manufacturer, as you know. We have Unifly, that is a provider of services for U-Space. We have large drone manufacturer coming from Israel, that is IAI. And so we have a lot of different representatives from different sectors of the market so that we can build up a common knowledge and expertise. The project is called AW Drones because the original scope of the project was only airworthiness, so standards for airworthiness for Mars market drones. Then the scope has been enlarged in accordance with the Commission in order to cover the operations, also U-Space and the autonomous UAS operations. This has been decided with an eye to the development of operation-centric regulation, as we saw before. The new headline is not anymore airworthiness of Mars market drones, but it's rather harmonizing drone standards to support the ongoing EU regulatory process. What we do specifically in the project? So we collect the information on the ongoing and planned work of the standard making bodies with regards to both technical and operational standards for drones with a global scope. Once we identify the standards that are of interest, we also perform a critical assessment of or benchmarking of the collected data. And we identify potential gaps, bottlenecks, and the applicability of the standards. In other words, we build a meta standard. So a combination of standards that can be applied to the different categories of operations, to U-Space, and so on. We propose and validate at the end a well-reasoned set of standards for each category of drone operation. One key point of the project is for sure to engage with key stakeholders and the end users in order to have representatives coming from all the domain. What we do not do, we are frequently asked whether we produce new rules, and that's not definitely the role of a research project, but it's the role of the authority. We do not produce new UAS standards because this is the role of the standard making bodies. And we do not assess the effectivity and technical quality of UAS standards. We assume that they are technically perfect, very good, because they are built up by authoritative organization doing this. We only check whether that those specific standards are fitting well with the EU rules and the other way around. Okay, the scope of the project. In year 2019, we did a full collection and assessment of standards for Zora, and that was a huge work. We collected more than 600 standards and we assessed them. And at the end, we identified also 47 gaps. So topics and requirements of Zora that are not yet fully covered by the currently developed standard framework. During last year, we focused instead on U-Space, and we did a second iteration of Zora. We collected and assessed 30 standards for U-Space. The numbers are different, definitely different, because the U-Space regulation is not yet mature enough, and in general, the concept of U-Space is not yet fully developed. Well, this year will be devoted to standards supporting highly automated or autonomous operation with UAS, with an eye also on the airworthiness and safety of drones in the specific category. We adopt an iterative approach. It means that during year two, for example, we studied U-Space, but we also continued studying SORA standards, and it will be the same also for year three. This is because both the regulation and the standard development are continuously evolving, and new standards are published, new rules are published, and it is needed to go on with the assessment. Okay, this is very briefly the flow. We start from one side from the regulatory requirement, for example, the safety objectives defined in SORA. On the other side, we have the standards. We check whether the standard or the standards are adequate to cover that specific requirement. If it is the case, the standard is given to EASA as an acceptable mean to comply with the requirement, and the final decision whether to consider it an AMC or not is definitely on EASA side. Ours is only a suggestion to them. Whether in the case where the standard is not deemed, is not considered adequate, we can identify the gaps. If no standards cover a specific requirement, it means that there is a gap. Standards that need to be further developed, or definitely new standards that need to cover it. The main key performance areas that are addressed by our assessment are safety and security. The assessment is performed by a multi-criteria analysis. I would not focus too much on the weights that we gave to the different criteria, because those have been negotiated and discussed a lot. But we can look a bit at the criteria that we consider in the assessment. So we start with the effectiveness to fulfill that specific requirement. That is the most important criterion. Then we have the maturity of the standard, whether it has been published, is still under external review, or so on. The type of standard, whether it is prescriptive, for example, or only a guidance material. The cost of compliance, that is very important to understand whether the use of a specific standard is in line with the proportionality. So, for example, if we want a low-risk operations operator to comply with the very prescriptive standards, it couldn't be so much proportionate to the risk. Then we have considerations about the environmental impact of the usage of a certain standards. What is the impact on the EU industry competitiveness? For example, whether the standard is already close to some of the quality processes that are in place in Europe or something like that. And finally, we have the social acceptance of some specific standards. Obviously, all of this work is not performed, is not carried out in isolation, but we involve experts. The main stakeholders of the project are EASA and DGMove, so the Commission, and they give feedback and steer the work in the dedicated workshop. We also have on board experts coming from other regulatory organizations. We have manufacturers and operators. They build up our advisory board and they give us advice about the methodology, bring an external view, and so on. We also tend to meet a large number of stakeholders, and we do it via the annual yearly workshops and some online surveys that are released every year. So we meet a lot of manufacturers, operators, and so on. The outcomes of the project are nearly deliverable with the state of the art of standards. And it is made also of a report containing the set of standards that have been identified with their applicability, maturity, and effectiveness. So in other words, the assessment. And we also have a drone standard information portal that contains the structured information produced by the project. This is a view on the results, for example, on SORA we have had until now. You can see, without going too much into details here, that we saw that some of the requirements of SORA have been already fully covered by the current standards, currently existing standards, while other have a partial or no coverage at all. Here you can see on a pie that the 30% of SORA requirements are already fully covered, 60% have a partial coverage from the currently existing standards, and we have also some requirements that are not covered at all. And in fact, for SORA, we identified 47 gaps, and 90% of them lead to the issue of a recommendation to the SDO to develop or modify the standards in order to cover those specific requirements that are not yet covered. All this information, you can find it on our open access repository, the drone portal, the drone standard portal, where you can find all the relevant information about standards, gaps, and categorization of standards for category of drones. You can reach the website here at this link or from the project website, standards.awdrones.eu. As you can see, we already put there all the standards we collected and assessed, more than 600. They are categorized, for example, there are several ways to explore those data. You can explore them based on the requirement, for example, here, SORA OSOS. You can explore them by domains that are defined here, like UAS operations, airworthiness, and so on. And okay, once you reach the single standard, you can have some very general information here, for example, the organization that issued it. You can group them by keywords and propose new keywords and so on. Search them by their name. And finally, once you get into the requirement, you can see a lot of information about the standard and also the result of the assessment. If you go now to the portal, you will not find some of this information. For example, the assessment is not yet present because we are going through a review together with the EASA of the assessment, but you can at least see all the list of the standards that we already assessed, look at them, look at their categorization, and so on. Okay, you can reach the project and me on the web, on several social networks. So please keep in touch, reach us, and thank you very much for your attention. And if you have questions, please, this is the time for doing this, or otherwise you can also write me and I will be glad to answer your questions. Thank you very much.